And my parents were really active though in our neighborhood, like just kind of helping people make sure they had what they need. Making sure that people, you know, if somebody needed a little help, somebody needed a little extra money, somebody needed help with city government, something like that, my parents were really always interested in helping people. So for me, I saw them being politically engaged, meaning how did they find ways to help people? How they find ways to help a person get something they otherwise wouldn't have been able to get. And so I'm asking you what politics mean to you. What it means to me ultimately is what are we doing to help one another be our best self. Now, I saw them do that as I was coming up and participating in that, but I never wanted to be a politician like I am now. I actually wanted to be an engineer. Anybody ever done a DAPSET program? Anybody ever heard of that? One person, you did DAPSET program, okay. So, when I was little, my grandma bought me a computer when I was 5. And I was first getting my body to have a computer. And I really fell in love with it. And so, that love of technology, that computer, made me want to be an engineer. So I obviously went to school to be an engineer. I went to University of Michigan and graduated from college engineering. I went to work at Microsoft as a software developer. That's what I did in my career. And that was great. I was having a really good time. I actually moved out of Michigan. I moved to Seattle, Washington to do that work. And I did that for 4 years. And then I got a chance to work on Barack Obama's first presidential campaign. I got a chance to be a volunteer, like kind of calling people to see, to encourage them to volunteer, calling them, encouraging them to vote. And ultimately I got a chance to set up programs for people to be able to use social media to participate in a political presidential campaign. That had never happened before that campaign. And so I was helping people get on social media for political purposes, using things that y'all probably have never heard of. So Twitter was founded in 2007. We're using a social network called MySpace, which y'all probably never even heard of. Some called Friendster, some of y'all probably never even heard of. This is really when it was basic, when Facebook was still basically only on college campuses. This is stuff we were using to help connect people to the political process. And I did that, had a lot of fun with it. And so I actually ended up leaving my job at Microsoft to go ahead and work in politics as a professional in Washington, D.C. for 5 years. I learned a lot again about how to help people, about how to make sure people have what they need in terms of healthcare, in terms of economic resources, et cetera. So I came home 7 years ago to Detroit to actually work in city government. Again, trying to figure out how I could help people be their best self in the city of Detroit where I live. And more or less, that's what I was doing before I ran for office 4 years ago to be Detroit city clerk to try to run the election process in Detroit. Came really close, but I lost. And then less than a year later, Governor Gretchen Whitmer asked me to be her running mate. So I've been in office for 3 years. And the whole time, the intention or my hope for that service was to try to find a way so that people like y'all could be successful. And what I mean by that is it's my job to make sure that you as individuals, the neighborhoods you live in, the city we live in, the schools you go to are well supported so they can give you what you need to do whatever you want to do in life. And I don't know if that always happens, and I'm sure y'all can tell me when that doesn't happen, but the intention is for me to try to create the conditions for you to be successful. And for you to be successful, like here in Detroit, in Michigan, I thought I needed to be successful. In order to be successful, I thought I had to go somewhere else to do that. And I was lucky enough to find a way to do it. But we had to make that reality different for people, for y'all, for your classmates, for your family members, et cetera. And so, to me, and what I want to hear from you is, again, if you decided to come to something called Peace and Politics, like, why? What do you care about that said, I want to be part of this program? So who's brave enough to be the first person to answer that question for me?
Mm-hmm.
You. What's your name?
Corday.
What is it?
Corday.
Corday.
Yeah.
Okay, what school do you go to?
University.
You go to this school?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, I can't ask that question again.
You speak up.
He said, why you want to come here?
Why are you here today?
I wanted to like know something besides like sports and stuff like that, just in case sports don't work out for me.
So you want to know about politics.
Politics, yeah.
Something to possibly do. Okay, somebody else, somebody here today.
Yeah.
So both of y'all, you Micah and you Cordae, y'all said that you were interested in this as a possible field and learn something about it. So I appreciate that. There's a lot of different ways to be connected to or to work in politics. All of them don't mean that you have to be or try to be an elected official. I have to try to run for office, I try to be out here talking to people, going to people's homes, things like that. There are a lot of ways you can work and support that. Because anybody who's an elected official like me, or like mayor, or governor, or whatever, none of us can actually become that working all by ourselves. We need a lot of people to help us. We need a lot of people who work with us when we're actually in office. We need a lot of people who are smarter than us, actually understand all the systems that we have to manage. So politics impacts like literally everything in your life.
I not do nothing about it. Like if you check out, if you say, you know, yeah, this is bad, but I can't do anything about it, if you accept that, then you're right. You can't. So I want to talk about, let's be practical about those three things. So you're worried about people driving really fast on your streets. What would make people drive slow? Speed bumps? So if you have a speed bump on your street, people drive slower, they don't try to mess up their car. You got a speed bump on your street. Okay. So somebody tried to solve that problem. They said, you know what, people driving too fast, let's get a speed bump on the street. You know how that happened? Yeah, so let me tell you how that speed bump came on your street. Because you're not the first person who was worried about people driving real fast on your street. And so people on your street got together and they said, we need to do something about this. It's dangerous. Our kids play outside, whatever's happening, we're worried about people getting hit, people crashing into cars on the side of the street. So people on your block got together. People in whether it's your neighborhood association, people got together and they said, we want to do about this. And they went to the city and said, y'all need to do something about this. It's dangerous. We got people to sign a piece of paper, and we need a solution because we want a speed bump put on our street. That speed bump didn't just happen. And like, the government didn't just decide to put a speed bump on there. Everything the government does is in response to somebody asking to do. And so they tried one solution, which was put a speed bump there to see if that would work. But you're telling me that that's still not enough, right? And that people are still going too fast. So then I think the next opportunity, and this is something that you can actually do. You don't have to be voting age to do it. What you can do is find out who those people were who tried to get that speed bump there in the first place. Say, all right, y'all, this is great. This is progress, but it's not working. So I want us to figure out what else we can do. We need to try to figure out a way to get a traffic light on the corner for the main street that's closest to ours. We need to figure out a way to reroute traffic someplace else. We need to try to make the street a one-way. We can think of ideas together to make something else happen. And like, that's something that you have to have a power with. You can lead them. And I'll tell you something, as a younger person, may not always feel like it, but on stuff like this, older people will actually listen to you. Anybody got ideas about what you do about gas prices? Use less gas, get an electric car. I like electric cars, they're expensive though, but I like it. Ride a bike, okay, ride a bike. You don't have to pay, you don't have to use any gas to ride a bike, that's true. Pardon me?
Okay.
You can have
more gas
money.
More gas
money. More gas lines. Okay, so like, have more gas available. You're saying if there's more gas available, then it would be less expensive. Okay, that's a good, yeah, econ 101 lesson, I like that. What's yours? What's your idea?
Taking a city bus.
Taking a city bus?
Yeah.
I'm hearing a lot of ideas about, okay, gas is expensive, so you need to find a way to get where you're going. It doesn't mean you have to spend money on gas. Find some alternatives. Making the system have more supply so that it will be less expensive. I think all this is good. All this stuff about other alternatives is really solid. But before I took office, I took the bus exclusively. I didn't drive. My family didn't have a car for me and my wife and my kids.
So we take the bus everywhere. We take the bus to the grocery store. I take the bus to work. I ride bikes to work.
So yeah, that's, sometimes you can find a way to do that. That depends on where you live, where you need to get, what you need to carry. Sometimes that'll work for people, sometimes that won't. I think encouraging people to use these alternative kinds of transportation when they can, that does make a difference. And you can encourage people to do that. You can also, you're talking about how can we have more gas available. That can be tricky, it's not impossible. But thinking about, again, where are these gas stations even at in our community? Maybe part of the reason why it's so expensive is because there's only one gas station in this neighborhood. We need to find another way for them to be supplied. All of these things, all these ideas y'all have are valid ideas about how to change your community. And I think the community is missing out if you don't share them. All of y'all are connected people in your community, in the school, et cetera, and have enough power to be able to actually elevate these ideas, talk about them in ways that can change the community in the way you want to see it get better. And you have the power to do that. You have the power to do that. I just encourage you to do it. So yeah, so your last one was what now?
Violence
in the community. All right, this is a good one. So, raise your hand if you lost somebody to gun violence in your life. I'm gonna say it's heavy. Me too. It's something that we all, unfortunately, if we haven't experienced it personally, we know somebody who has. Almost everybody. That's probably true for almost everybody. Why did it happen?
Hate.
Say hate. People hate one another. This crew hates this crew. Somebody got into a dispute that escalated. So what do we do to fix that? It's a lot we got to do to fix that. And I think that's something that we can deal with at every level. So I'll talk about like in my level. So again, I live in Detroit. I'm a statewide elected official. I think that we would have less violence in our communities if people felt like there was a lot of pathways to your future in your community. Like you could do a lot of different things. You had a lot of pathways to making the kind of money you wanted to make. That didn't mean you had to go take it to somebody else. There were a lot of pathways that were diverse, where you didn't necessarily feel like your only option was drug gang, that you didn't feel like your only option was something that was violent. But we gotta invest in people in communities in order to make that true. Invest in making sure that people have jobs, invest in making sure that kids can go to school in ways that are safe, making sure that people can go to higher education if that's what they want. It's like my job, what I've tried to do, and even this year, has been working on actually delivering resources to school buildings like this one, school districts like ours, be able to actually have more money for programs for kids to be able to see your future, see what you want to do. We also, I think, we have a chance on policy. I asked about gun violence specifically, because it would be less gun violence, there were fewer guns. Less people had guns on the street. And a lot of guns that are flowing through our community, especially handguns, a lot of them got there illegally. A lot of them got there coming from somebody out of state, passed down from somebody who acquired it illegally. So we're trying to work on how to like cut off just the number of guns that are available in our community, because all they're doing is killing people, not protecting them. That's what we own. And what can you do like on the community level, on the block level, on the relationship level? What can you do to bring the temperature down? You talk about hate. The hate is that's just riled up every time. Somebody gets angry and they take it out. So what can we do to like bring people together? How can we bring the temperature down so that beef doesn't always end like that? I think that's the responsibility that we all have, and we all can do something about that. Like if you know somebody, this happened in my own life, you know somebody who was ready to take that step, who was so upset about something that happened, something that happened to them, something that was taken from them, someone who was taken from them. They were ready to take that step. But they are one conversation away from not taking that step. And so we got to do that like on a person-to-person level. And while we're trying to deal with the structural stuff, make sure that we're not all arguing and fighting about poverty, that we are not all having to confront so many guns that are in our community, that we have access to education and resources and a path out of a neighborhood if we want to move out of that neighborhood. That's all stuff that you can impact too. It's all stuff that we can impact together. And so I wanted to go through those three different examples, like way different examples. I don't know if all of y'all live in the same neighborhood, or y'all live in different parts of the city, but like all these types of things, there's a pathway for you to change it. And so when we're thinking about all of you came here because you were interested in politics on some level, had some idea what politics meant, what I want to challenge you with is that politics is really about what you make, how you participate in, because you have a role to play in deciding how we go forward. And we're not gonna go forward the way we need to without. And all of that exists even before you get voting age. Anybody here 18? Anybody 18?
No.
Party?
It's
what? All of you not being 18 means that you have something to look forward to as a voter. I hope that everybody registered to vote on their 18th birthday. I hope this school has voter registration to help make that happen. But even before your voting age, you can impact the political process. Did anybody know what the lieutenant governor actually is?
I
just lied to you. I did that on purpose because I didn't want this conversation to be like all about me. But let me tell you what my job actually is. So, y'all know what the responsibilities of the governor of Michigan are?
No.
No? Okay. You know what the responsibilities of the president of the United States are?
Barely.
Kind of. That's what I'm hearing.
No.
So, the governor of Michigan is the head of the executive branch of government in Michigan. Anybody know when I say executive branch, I know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what the three branches of government are?
Mm-hmm.
What are they?
Legislative,
executive, judicial. Okay, good. And y'all know the responsibilities of the three branches of government? No responsibilities? Okay, a little bit. Okay, that's all good. We can cover that quick. The legislative branch decides what the laws are. Okay? Decides what the law is. The executive branch carries out what the law is, executes, actually does what the law says. And the judicial branch clears up any confusion about what the law means. Okay? Judicial tells you what the law is. Executive branch does what the law does. Judicial branch tells you what the law means. Y'all got that? Okay. So in the executive branch, the state government, we have those three branches of government at the state level. The chief executive is the governor of Michigan. So in this case, Gretchen Whitmer, her responsibility is to carry out what the law says. She has a lot of responsibilities in doing it. Has to run every state department and agency. That's everything from the Department of Transportation to the National Guard, the state's military, to the and everything in between. Just like there's a president and a vice president, at the state level, there's a governor and lieutenant governor. So she's the number one executive in the state, I'm the number two. So we work together to divide the responsibilities of that office and of what we need to execute. Now on the state level, there's a couple other things that are a little different. So in addition to playing that role alongside the governor, as part of that, that means that also, so the governor has to travel from time to time outside of the state of Michigan. Whenever she travels outside of the state of Michigan, I become the governor while she's gone. And so that's actually true right now. So right now, I'm the acting governor of the state of Michigan. Now, so all those responsibilities I talked about, that's all mine. till she comes back. Now, in addition to those responsibilities, I also do play a role in the state legislature. Let's dive into the legislative branch of government. So in the state of Michigan, there's something called a state senate and a state house. There's two legislative bodies. Did y'all know that?
Yeah.
Okay. It's kind of like the federal government, a house and a senate. So I am also the president of the state senate. I lead the state senate. What that means is I basically have to manage the state senate and run all that in addition to my other responsibilities. So that's what my job is, to work alongside the governor to help execute on the laws of the state of Michigan and to be the president of the state senate and to be there when she's gone. Basically, the Michigan state constitution outlines my job that way. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Okay. What other questions do y'all have? Yeah. I didn't get your name the first time, I'm sorry.
Robert.
Okay, Robert.
Why don't they just call you Vice Governor?
Why what?
I said, why don't they just call you Vice Governor?
Why don't they just Vice instead of Lieutenant? That's a really good question. I have no idea. That was a decision that was made a long time ago. I don't know. But it's the same type of responsibility. Like the Vice President has a similar role to the Lieutenant Governor, although Vice President Harris does not assume the role of acting president when the president leaves the country. She does not become president. The only way that the vice president becomes the president is the president is removed from office, incapacitated, or dies. And so that's the big difference. But she's also the president of the United States. Okay, you haven't said anything like out loud.
What's your opinion on the vaccine?
Okay. She asked me what my opinion is on the vaccine. I'm assuming you're talking about the COVID-19 vaccine, right? I think that everybody who's eligible for a vaccine, which is everybody in this room, should get vaccinated.
You vaccinated?
Yes, absolutely. I'm about to get a booster shot tomorrow morning. I got twin eight-year-olds. I got twin eight-year-olds who were born on my birthday. I got my babies, get their first vaccine dose 2 Saturdays ago. First Saturday, we were eligible to get vaccinated. I got a two-year-old who I would get vaccinated if she was eligible. I'm gonna tell you why. I've had a unique perspective on seeing the COVID-19 pandemic and how deadly it's been. Personally, 27 people I know personally in my life who I have meaningful relationships with, like numbers in my cell phone, 27 people I know have died of COVID-19. Family members, friends, my AAU basketball coach, the associate minister of my church, cousins, people I work with currently, used to work with, I know all these people who are dead from COVID-19. So this is not like a theoretical thing to me. People dying of COVID-19 is real. The other thing I've seen is, and I guess almost all the students here are students of color, in this pandemic in Michigan, this particular virus killed black people in Michigan at a rate 5 times more likely to kill black folks than it was to kill white people in Michigan. This has been a deadly, deadly virus in our community. And I actually have led the state's response to try to make this virus less deadly to black people in Michigan, to try to respond to that at the state level to do something about that. And so over the last year plus, we've been trying to do that to our best of our ability. And it was hard to do. We made progress and never do that. And these vaccines became available at the end of last year. And these vaccines really work. They work not because they removed your possibility of getting COVID-19, because you still might get it, but they make it much more likely that you will survive. I know a whole lot of people who got COVID-19 and are still not the same. They still can't breathe right. They still can't taste their food. They still can't feel their fingertips. I've seen that personally. And the question that I have, because I don't want more people to die from it, and these vaccines are really good at stopping people from dying. Nothing's 100%. That's true. Nothing's 100%. Nothing's 100%. But they work really, really well and are incredibly, incredibly effective. didn't plan on being lieutenant governor. So yeah. So I had my plan in life was to go to Michigan. And then after I worked for Microsoft, I was going to quit and go to business school, and I was going to start a business in Detroit. That was my plan. I didn't plan on becoming an elected official. I don't know how long I'm going to be an elected official. I'm up for election next year. I'm trying to get reelected, so I'd like to serve for at least another 4 years. But if that doesn't happen, I'm still 100% confident in myself that I could go start a business or go get a job and do whatever I need to feed my wife and my 3 kids. So, but let me say something about planning. I think everyone should try to make a life plan. You should try to do that. It's important. It's helpful. I would imagine that y'all who decided to be in here are relatively ambitious and have ideas about what you want to do and who you want to be. I had ideas about that. I told you what my plan was at a high level. I think, in addition to having a plan, what's important is to make sure that you are also taking full advantage of the experiences that are right in front of you. Because while I had a plan, I didn't follow that plan very closely. And I think, though, that stuff is more or less working out pretty well for me. And that gives me confidence to see that as long as I'm taking everything from the experiences that I do have, I can be prepared to do something good in the future. So I want you and all of you really to think about, you know, what do you want to do, who you want to be, and just recognize there might be a lot of different paths to getting there and being open to taking when they come from. Cameron, you had a question. How about police brutality? How am I thinking about police brutality and stuff that's happening with police in the community, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So thank you for that question. That's real important. So when I was in, when I was a senior, when I was in 12th grade, I witnessed an act of police brutality. Like I saw somebody at that gas station and saw Detroit police beat somebody up and tried to stop it, which in hindsight probably wasn't a wise thing to do because I could have got some of that action too. But try to stop that. I've had to deal with discrimination from law enforcement and intimidation from law enforcement since I was 9. That was the first time I got confronted by the police for no reason. I just moved out to Farmington. We moved, and me and some kids in the neighborhood were playing football, and somebody called the police, and the police got there. It's all white kids and me. I'm bigger than all of them, and they came right at me and took all my information, blah, blah, told me they was going to see me again, all that stuff. I've been dealing with this since I was a kid. I got a lot of y'all probably have had similar experiences wherever you've been. You know, I think the first thing we have to do is we got to recognize that the relationship between the police and the people that the police serve, it's definitely been strained. It's definitely been strained. And the fact that so many people in our community don't trust the police is understandable. And we got to fix that. And everybody's got a role to play in fixing that. Law enforcement has a role to play in fixing that. We as a community have a role to play in fixing that. And so we got to figure out how to do it together. I think it's a few things. One, making sure that everybody has the same goals when we're dealing in the community. I want everybody to go home at the end of every night. And if you see the police, I still want you to be able to go home at the end. I want you to be able to go home. I want the police officer to be able to go home. I want everybody to be able to go home at the end of any interaction. Police even have a saying that says everybody goes home. It's on the wall basically in every police station you see, everybody goes home. And I want that to be true for all of us. In order for that to be true, we got to make sure a couple things happen. One, we have to make sure that the rules that police govern themselves by actually are about keeping people alive and not hurting. You got to make sure the rules are there. So that getting choked out by the police, that should be illegal. It's not in Michigan. The way you can get hemmed up in particular ways, that should be illegal in communities in Michigan. It's not necessarily. Needing to make sure that if one law enforcement professional sees another law enforcement professional doing something they shouldn't be doing. They should have a responsibility to step in and stop that. That's not guaranteed right now in the state of Michigan. So I, personally, the governor as well, we've proposed changing the laws to make all those things true and delivering some accountability for law enforcement professionals when, if and when those things happen. We proposed those things explicitly more than a year ago. Now, in addition to that, we also need to recognize that we need to like actually help law enforcement professionals be successful at their job. They need support too. Because it's not like it's an easy job. I ask anybody who's a law enforcement professional in my family, and it's a bunch of them. It's not an easy job. So we need to make sure that they actually feel supported in work. For example, if you have been working on a job as law enforcement for 10 years, you probably have seen a whole lot of stuff. You've seen a lot of people on their worst day and their worst moment. And that can really impact how you see people. But you know that we police officers or law enforcement professionals are not required to actually talk to somebody about how they feel about work, to get a mental health evaluation. People, when they have incident after incident after incident with members of the public, are not required to actually talk to somebody about that to get help. That means you're turning people into ticking time bombs. But we actually have an opportunity to support people in that. And so we've offered and proposed resources for law enforcement to help them do their jobs better. They'll create incentives for law enforcement professionals to actually live where they work. A lot of times, this is true in Detroit police, the DPD, a lot of Detroit police officers don't live in Detroit. And a lot of people, when you're policing in a community where you don't live, sometimes you make assumptions about the people who you're policing. But we think that if people actually live where they serve, that could also help to change that relationship. You might have a different relationship with a police officer if the only time you saw them wasn't when they were trying to break something up or stop something or when they had their gun on them. So I think that's some of the stuff that we can do, and we're trying to make a difference on that in Michigan. When I came home to Detroit in 2017. I lived in Washington, D.C. for 5 years, and I came home in 2014, 7 years ago. And I was working for the city. And I was I worked in the technology department for the city. So I was like building technology systems. I made an app for the city called Improve Detroit for people to report like broken street lights and if a tree fell down and blocked the sidewalk and stuff like that, these kind of non-emergency service requests. Pardon me?
I said I didn't know it was an effort.
It's an effort. Yeah, it's called Improve Detroit. I made that. So I was doing system kind of stuff like that. And so some people approached me in 2016 after the presidential election and asked me to consider running for office, which I had never considered before, but it was for local office to be the Detroit City Clerk. Y'all know who the Detroit City Clerk is? What that is? Shaking hands, no. So the Detroit City Clerk is the person who administers the elections locally in Detroit. And the person who basically manages all the public information for the city. So somebody asked me to run for that office, which I did. And that's, like I said, I was unsuccessful. I didn't win that election. I lost real close. I lost by 1,400 votes. But that opened me up to thinking, well, maybe I should run for office in the future. Maybe I could do that. Maybe I could be all right at it. But I was doing a different job, completely different work outside of politics when now Governor Whitmer asked me to be her running mate. I was actually working at the University of Michigan. And the reason I said yes is because, like, me and my wife talked about it, and like, what we thought was, I ran for Detroit City Clerk because I wanted to make a difference in my community at a different level. Like, I was helping people with working for the government. I thought I could make a difference in a bigger way in that elected office. And so basically what she said to me was, well, if you're doing this role at the state level, you probably can do even more than you ever dreamed, even more than you ever imagined. And so we should think about it. And so I got into it because I thought it was an opportunity to be able to help people in a bigger way. And so that's what encouraged me to do this. And I met Gretchen Whitmer in 2017, and we built a strong relationship pretty quickly. I trusted her, my kids trust her, which is important. And so that's what encouraged me to say yes. So that is why I ran for Lieutenant Governor.
So how much do you enjoy being?
It's fantastic. I'm having fun. I get to see. So I'll tell you. So, so I tell you, I lived in Detroit and Farmington in my childhood. As lieutenant governor, I'm responsible for the entire state of Michigan, Lower Peninsula, Upper Peninsula. Y'all know Michigan is the biggest state physically, like east of the Mississippi River. I know that. Michigan is bigger than every other state on this side of the Mississippi River. It's huge. And as a kid, I had never seen most of it. The only thing I did, look, I played basketball growing up, competitive basketball. So like, I played a few basketball tournaments in Kalamazoo, a few basketball tournaments in Lansing. I went to a basketball camp up north in Cadillac. That was basically the only time I'd ever been anywhere outside of Metro Detroit. So one of the most amazing things about this job is I get to go anywhere I want in Michigan and see it. I get to take my kids. I took my kids to the Upper Peninsula. I took my kids to Mackinac Island. Like, I had never seen any of that when I was a child. Never seen any of that. Didn't know it was a thing. And Michigan has a lot to offer people. And so I enjoy being able to do that. And yeah, enjoy being able to make a difference on some really big important stuff. On things like make sure everybody in Michigan has internet access, on make sure people can get their criminal records cleared, saving people from dying from coronavirus. Like all that stuff really has been fulfilling to try to work on and work toward. So I'm having a good time. Yeah.
What are some things
that have changed since you've been lieutenant governor? That's your question? Okay. So a couple things. One, I talked on it in my answer to your question about the vaccine, something that is life and death and I'm real proud of, is we have dramatically reduced the rate at which people are dying from COVID-19, particularly Black folks and people of color. And I led a task force on racial disparities in the pandemic and really proud of that progress. And that wouldn't happen had me and Gretch Whitman not been nominated. That wouldn't happen. The second thing is next school year, this coming school year, some of it this year, but this year and the next school year, schools like this and schools across the state will have more resources than they ever had. Because we made the biggest, we passed the biggest state education budget in the history of the state of Michigan. And more stuff now available to schools to be able to meet needs and students like you. That's the thing. The third thing, I've been doing a lot of stuff on the criminal justice system to make the system work better. And so there are a lot of people in Michigan, a lot of people in my family, for example, who have some kind of something on their criminal record and made it hard for them to get a job, made it hard for them to go to school, made it hard for them to get an apartment. So I led our work to pass some new laws that make it really easy for people to clear their criminal record so they can actually get a job, get a home, go to school, or whatever. So those are three examples of things that have changed, like fundamentally since I came to office. Okay, I got time for two more. All right, you good with that, Gary? Okay, two more. All right. Anybody who has not asked a question, or y'all always the only one to talk. You know what I'm saying? You have not said anything. Yes.
I have not. So,
what's your name?
Oh, my name is Taurus.
Tori?
Taurus. Okay. That's my second name, Tori. But anyway, so my question is, if I was to, like, get into politics, you know, like, get to where you are, how much does it help financially?
So look, the question, I'll make sure everybody heard it. He said, I'm sorry, I'm going to go something. Said, how much, if someone was to get to where I am, like, what is the impact, what does that mean financially? Okay. Let me tell you something. If I was still a software engineer at Microsoft, instead of lieutenant governor of Michigan, I would make a whole lot more money. I'd make probably at least three times more money than I make. Now granted, my salary's not bad. I make $111,000 a year.
$111,000
a year. Yeah, it's pretty damn good. right? Lie. My responsibility, but that's what I make right now. And that's public information. You can see how much I make, see how much the governor made, see how much the mayor made. I make less than that. Here's the thing, though. And I think this is true of most people who are in elected office. You don't go to elected office if you're trying to get rich. That is not the path to getting rich. Going to elected office. You make a whole lot, you can make a whole lot more money. And I'm saying that recognizing that that's not a bad salary. You make a whole lot more money with a degree in something else than doing this. That's not my problem.
You got a problem.
Yeah. So, are you doing it because you want to make Michigan win a place? Doing it because, or are you doing it because, like, it's fun to you? No, no. I like acting how I like. Do you like doing it because it's fun to you, or do you want to make Michigan like a very good point?
Both. Yeah. I mean, the answer is both. Those things are not in competition with you. The answer is both. Okay. I got time for one more. It's going to be the most important. Two of them I just talked about in answer to your question about what's different. I think that us getting more money to schools than have ever gotten to schools, I think it's going to make a big difference for a whole generation of people. I think that's going to be one of the lasting legacies. And the second one is this thing about helping people clear their criminal records. There's almost a million people in Michigan who can't get a job because they got a criminal record, which means they can't make the money they should be able to make, at least not legal. And so I think that's gonna be a game changer for people being able to make money and get work and improve their lives and their families. We did that, we signed that into law last year. I think those are gonna be two of the things that had the biggest impact from our service. Okay. Well, thank you, everybody, for...